The night America began her bloody assault on Fallujah, young British Muslims, supporters of the insurgency in Iraq, took over the courtyard of London's Regent's Park Mosque. The words were inflammatory, invoking images of beheadings downloaded from the internet.
The obligation is jihad. We need to raise the sword and we need to have the heads rolling. We need more American soldiers. We need more British soldiers. We want them killed.
Internet videos of beheadings are designed to stir Muslims' blood. This webmaster in Britain feeds their anger.
They have their heads sawn off by the insurgents.
Yeah.
It is videoed, and that video is then posted on your website.
No problem with that. I think the people have the right to see it, and the people who made it have the right to do it.
There's a view in some quarters that the threat from Al-Qaeda is a nightmare dreamt up by politicians to hold electorates in their thrall. Having spent 30 years reporting terrorism, almost three studying Al-Qaeda, and months investigating the carnage at Madrid's main railway station, it's not a view that I share.
Did 9/11 happen? Yes, it did. Did Bali happen? Yes, it did. Did Casablanca happen? Did Madrid? Was the attack that was intended to be mounted in Strasbourg real? Did Sajid Badat and Richard Reid intend to bring down airliners? Yes, they did. Badat by his own admission. If you look at all of these things, it's difficult to say that the threat is exaggerated. It's clearly real.
But Al-Qaeda has changed. The internet has given it wings. It's no longer the tight organization behind 9/11, but a loose network of groups linked by the internet and dedicated to jihad, holy war. They're planning attacks in the West and suicide bombings in Iraq.
The only safe haven that remains right now for Al-Qaeda is the virtual realm, and it's one that we should all be very concerned about.
Al-Qaeda has become a global brand, driven by the power of the World Wide Web. In London's West End, MI5 are tracking a young British Muslim. They're hoping to recruit him as an agent. A year earlier, he'd travelled to Afghanistan to taste life under the Taliban.
When the Taliban came into power, people were claiming that they're living by the Islamic law and the Islamic rules. So I thought, OK, right, if that's the case, I need to take a look.
Andrew is not a terrorist, but some people he met in Afghanistan were. They included Richard Reid, who later tried to blow up an airliner with a bomb concealed in his shoe.
Met him in Kabul, broad daylight. He was packing, had a gun on him, an AK-47 to be exact. He'd recognized me from London. When I was leaving, he wasn't too impressed. The general thing was, you're going back to the land of Pepsi and McDonald's and whatever. He had the view that there was Islamic rule there and therefore you should really opt to stay.
But Andrew came home. MI5 want to talk to him about one of his friends, the webmaster they believe plays a key role in the internet war. Andrew feels he's little option.
I'd go to a phone box, call them, and then they'd give me another set of instructions. They said it was to make sure that I wasn't being followed and to ensure my safety.
I gave them a ring. They'd redirect me to the final destination, which was at Van Tyne's hotel.
During meetings over several months, MI5 asked him to infiltrate mosques and report on radical clerics at home and abroad. They finally came to the point.
Then the suggestion came that they've been instructed to, at some point, offer me a job. And they'd leave me to think about that.
In Starbucks, MI5 got down to business. They wanted him to spy on his friend, the webmaster.
They presented me with photographs of Baba Ahmed and other Muslims they felt had illegal involvement in jihad. Very personal photographs of them coming out of their houses, entering their own cars.
What's your reaction when they show Baba Ahmed's picture to you?
I thought they were messing me about, because it's very well known to the Muslims who know me that I learned about Islam via him and friends who were around him and so on and so forth. So I thought, right, now I know that this is getting personal. This something's going on.
The first glimpse this morning of Baba Ahmed as he was...
Something was indeed going on. Baba Ahmed was eventually arrested without any help from Andrew, who declined MI5's offer of a fully paid job. Anti-terrorist police raided Ahmed's home and his office at Imperial College London, where he worked in IT. They took away computers and disks. He later told Andrew what happened.
They went to his house. They violated his house to a certain degree in that they you know, walked into the prayer room with shoes on. They pulled Qurans down. They put him in choke holds. He thought he was going to die. He felt himself being kicked and punched. They handcuffed his wife, even though it wasn't her they were looking for.
To disaffected Muslims, Baba Ahmed has become a cause célèbre. Andrew sees him fighting deportation by challenging the new fast-track extradition law. It's fast-track because America doesn't have to provide prima facie evidence, just information, which the defense can't challenge.
Justice will eventually be done to Baba, inshallah. He is a law-abiding citizen. He has never, ever committed any crime. He is not a terrorist at all.
Do you think your husband will be extradited?
I hope he isn't. I know he's innocent, and we will fight it to the end.
The US indictment claims Ahmed ran a website supporting terrorism, raised money for foreign fighters, and encouraged others to join violent jihad. It also alleges he possessed a classified American military document and tried to buy chemicals and fertilizers that can be made into bombs. And we've discovered that Pakistan is interested in Ahmed as well. Last year at Lahore Airport, intelligence officers arrested a computer expert believed to be at the center of Al-Qaeda's global internet operations. Under interrogation, he revealed how Al-Qaeda's jihadis communicate over the net. His name is Naeem Noor Khan. He's Baba Ahmed's cousin. As a result, several suspects were detained in the UK. According to our intelligence sources in Pakistan, Khan was working with Baba Ahmed, helping UK recruits travel to Afghanistan to support the Taliban. The cousins were part of the same network. Much of the evidence against Ahmed comes from computers, disks, and emails scrutinized by cybercrime specialists in America, where Ahmed's website was hosted.
You don't just bring a computer in here, you take it apart from stem to stern, you go through disks, the hard drive, every piece of capability and knowledge to get a read on what this individual may or may not have been up to.
Here they believe that convicting Baba Ahmed would set a legal precedent, that an advocate of violence is as much to blame as the person who actually carries it out.
The notion that a major player would be brought to heel, so to speak, it's precedent setting for those selected, carefully selected cases of the future that we would also like to see reckoned with here in the judicial system in the United States.
Do you regard Baba Ahmed as being a major player?
I'd label him a major player and one that the country is dramatically interested in getting resolved here.
This is why America is desperate to clamp down on what it calls internet terrorism. Iraq is the front line for the new Al-Qaeda. Few attacks take place without a camcorder, computer, and internet access, providing dramatic online theater to millions of homes all over the world.
While a picture may be worth 1,000 words, a video uploaded to an internet site is worth 10,000. You show a video of someone blowing themselves up, killing Americans, spreading American blood. that has an incalculable effect in terms of recruiting future terrorists.
In Iraq, most suicide attacks are carried out by foreign jihadis. The insurgents' manipulation of the internet is causing grave concern at the very top of the US military.
We find an awful lot of computers, we find computer disks. Instead of moving secret messages, people move secret computer disks. Your ability to get on the internet and pass a message through essentially an endless series of hubs and connectors presents a opportunity to send your message that's never been equaled by a terrorist organization before. When these few people become connected virtually, it gives them strength beyond which they would have geographically.
You'll see the martyr boarding the truck, wired with explosives. The target is that building right to the right. And then all of a sudden, but the explosion was not filmed from one angle, but three. Multiple angles, multiple shots. They understand the value of this. This is a media war.
And as in the media, videos need an outlet. For every jihadi film shot on a camcorder and uploaded to the web from Iraq, there has to be a distributor. Dr. Mohammed Al-Masari is one of them. He's a Saudi dissident who was given sanctuary by Britain. He supports his countryman, Osama bin Laden. His role is to download messages and images from Iraq and pass them on via his website.
You upload it to a trusted site, and the guy who is waiting for it to be uploaded, checking every few hours, will download it immediately and send it to whoever he wants.
And it just spreads?
It just spreads like fire in dry wood. It's unbelievable.
How important is the internet to the insurgents in Iraq?
For us, it's a matter of life and death, almost. Otherwise, we cannot get our message in our lifetime, so we'll die before. Now we are hopeful that our message will be received and respond to. They need influx of mujahideen. They need influx of money, influx of arms and support. And that all can come only from outside. This means it has to go through the internet.
There are dozens of internet sites set up solely to host videos and dispatches from Iraq, news groups and forums with names like The Fortress. Some are based in the US, where hosting companies are either unaware of their content or turn a blind eye. Others, like Mayflies, live for a few days, then die, only to spring up again with a new name. The momentum is unstoppable.
What's the process whereby the video is made on the spot of the suicide attack or whatever, and then it ends up on the screen of an internet cafe?
This is actually something that came up when US troops raided Fallujah earlier this year. They discovered that inside of Iraq, there are cyber cafes. There are internet laboratories. There are places where you can go, just like you can go in any other major city, and you can access high-speed internet. So what these folks did is they take cameras, video cameras that you can buy at any store anywhere in the world for $200 or $300 each. They go out, they film the operation. The video then makes it back to a cyber cafe, or it makes it back to an internet laboratory. Then that video is then copied by 30 other people onto mirror sites, they're called. So 24 hours later, if the original download link is offline, if the secondary download link is offline, you can keep going down that list, but eventually you're going to find someone like Dr. Mohammed Al-Masari.
Dr. Al-Masari justifies his actions by saying that he's just a publisher of other people's material and that he's not responsible for what they post on his website. It's an argument that may be deployed by Baba Ahmed's legal team.
This video was posted on your website.
Many other tools.
What does this say?
It's the Qaeda organization in the country of Two Rivers, the Qaeda organization in Iraq. That's the Iraqi Al-Qaeda organization headed by Abu Musab Zarqawi. This is this one.
And this video was posted on your website?
Yep, there are plenty of them.
This video depicts the killing of three members of the British Army near Baghdad last autumn.
And what are we seeing now?
he's coming to the point. They say your brother Abu Sulaiman is slowing down so that the civilian cars will pass through.
And Abu Sulaiman is a suicide bomber in the vehicle.
So he slows down. And then they say, in the name of Allah, they are waiting now because it's coming to the point.
And that is the voice of?
The commentator, the one who's watching.
And he's saying Allah is great.
Yeah. That car is now out.
Allah is great. And three soldiers of the Black Watch are dead, blown up by a suicide bomber.
Mm-hmm.
And this was posted on your website, a video which the vast majority of people watching this programme will find deeply offensive, and offensive that it was posted on your website.
No, I think the most offensive they should be finding is that Tony Blair is sending the boys there to die.
Videoed beheadings have also become part of the unsavoury diet of jihad.com. Such videos are monitored on behalf of the US and other governments by the Site Institute in Philadelphia. We were taken to its secret headquarters after being blindfolded to protect the location. Its walls are adorned with pictures of terrorists and their sympathisers.
I see you've got Richard Reed, the shoe bomber, who's in jail in America.
Zakaria Moussaoui.
Moussaoui, who
goes in that same line.
Who lived in London.
Right.
Site's current focus is on Iraq and how the insurgents are manipulating the internet.
Abu Masab al-Zarqawi's techniques when it comes to the internet is just unbelievable. And when I say Abu Masab al-Zarqawi, I talk about his internet committee, and I believe he has an internet committee that have the state-of-the-art technology. They will post a communique, we beheaded the individual, soon the video will be uploaded. Within an hour, you'll have the video on the internet with dozens of URLs, dozens, so everyone can review them. And you would see that immediately after that, the Mujahideens will ask to see more. And that was really serving as an unbelievable recruitment tool.
I think it's not only a recruiting tool, but it's also an organizational tool. Whether it's effective or not, there are people that will be attracted to this very dark form of ideology. They will look for the opportunity to witness beheadings, and unfortunately, the sick people are really attracted to this and they join up.
In May, there was a sudden explosion of Zarqawi material on websites, following reports that he'd been wounded in an American ambush. There were rumours his laptop had been seized, containing vital intelligence.
How close have you been to capturing Moussab al-Zarqawi?
I think it probably doesn't do a lot of good to say how close we were. The only thing that'll really matter is when we get him. And
you almost got him.
Zarqawi, bin Laden, and Zawahiri, for the rest of their lives, need to keep looking over their shoulders to worry about when the knock on the door might come, because it's going to come.
The beheading of the first U.S. hostage is believed to have been carried out by Zarqawi himself. Site analyzed responses on a pro-Al-Qaeda forum. Someone known only as BA24 posted the video.
In the name of Allah, the merciful and the compassionate, enclosing a link of the butchering of the first infidel American, can be downloaded quickly.
The effect is immediate.
Allah the Almighty, we will sacrifice ourselves for this call. It is like thunderbolts in the ears of the devils.
Publish this film. All of vile America's forums, and in that of his cousin Britain. Publish it in a minimum of 100 forums.
I have downloaded it and watched. What made me laugh most was the way the dirty infidel was shaking while the speech was delivered.
The response was a pile of skulls.
Also, videos have been posted on your website. Graphic videos showing the beheading of civilians.
No, it's not civilians. These are fighters.
These were American contractors. They're civilians.
They
are
all fighters.
They're contractors. They're working for the Americans. They're not military. They're working for the military.
In Islamic law, there's no definition called military or military.
They have their heads sawn off by the insurgents.
Yeah.
It is videoed, and that video is then posted on your website.
No problem with that, because they are with the occupation forces.
You don't have a problem with that being posted on your website?
No, I don't have a problem. I think the people have the right to see it, and the people who made it have the right to do it.
There are people in Britain who have websites that show videos of beheading, that show the suicide bombing of some of your soldiers and some of the British soldiers, and nothing is done about them.
Well, I think it's really time that we do something about it. I think we all ought to be outraged by it. I don't think anyone has the right to show the taking of life of a human being just for entertainment value or for recruiting value.
This March, a regular contributor to a forum known as Al Ansar died in a suicide bombing in Iraq. It was a cause for celebration. Congratulations, another member of the forum has been a martyr, the forum said, and posted his family's phone number so that other members could call in celebration.
Do you believe that young British Muslims are leaving the UK and going to fight with the insurgents in Iraq?
There is evidence that some, we don't know the precise numbers, could very well be very small. There is evidence that some young British men have left the United Kingdom with the intention of going to Iraq.
If someone is sufficiently young and sufficiently capable, he may think seriously to join them. And we know that this joining is continuously ongoing, massively. So that's really one of the most massive propaganda. And you know, human beings, if you see an enemy tank being blown in pieces, it gives you enormous feeling of satisfaction and also encouragement to do the same.
Do you really think that a young Muslim accessing this material in an internet cafe will say, I want to go and do the same, I want to go and fight?
I think so. It's very mobilizing.
Internet terrorism will provide the backdrop to the trial of Andrew's friend Baba Ahmed if he's extradited. Martial arts were an important part of Ahmed's routine, and Andrew followed in his footsteps. It was Baba Ahmed who converted Andrew to Islam.
He was very articulate with the way he presented Islam and what it is, what it means.
Was Baba Ahmed there when you converted?
Yeah, he was. Him and his brother were two witnesses. I remember because he came to my house, as he usually does, and asked me how I felt and where I was going, where I'm at, so on and so forth. Then he said that, well, I feel you know enough to convert, but the decision obviously has to be yours.
Baba Ahmed wasn't just converting young men in Tooting like Andrew. It's alleged he was able to reach a much wider audience of potential jihadis via the powerful computers in his office at Imperial College. According to the American indictment, it was here that he set up his website, azam.com, named after bin Laden's mentor, Abdullah Azam, one of the original Afghan mujahideen. It advocated fighting military jihad, a holy war against the enemies of Islam.
Azam.com played the role that bin Laden has now designated as his own, as the inciter, as the instigator, as a site that promoted contact and camaraderie among younger Muslims around the world, Muslims who were most likely to adopt the course of jihad.
Azam Publications has been set up to propagate the call for jihad among the Muslims who are sitting down ignorant of this vital duty. Thus, the purpose is to incite the believers. Muslims must use every means at their disposal to undertake military and physical training for jihad.
So in my mind, Azam.com was the prototype of what Al-Qaeda has, I think, rather masterfully expanded.
The American indictment charges that Baba Ahmed and Azam.com were essentially one and the same, and that he used an alias to conceal his identity. Azam posted incendiary bulletins from the jihadi front lines. Although Ahmed helped run Imperial College's Islamic Society, he's not remembered as a firebrand.
Was he a strong personality?
I think he was a strong personality, but not in the way that most people would recognise that term. I mean, he was always he was very articulate, but sort of always had a bit of humility around him, and wouldn't go out and make himself known.
Did he ever talk about jihad?
He did, and he would talk about jihad in all its forms. So starting from the actual sort of expressing your disagreement with something that is wrong, through all the way to taking being involved in war if there was an appropriate setting for that to happen.
We understand Ahmed went to Bosnia in the mid-90s, initially as part of a charity convoy, and then to fight his jihad. To the British, this wasn't illegal. This primitive video shows how the conflict was used to encourage young British Muslims to join the jihad.
That in the West, many brothers, they say to us that the Muslim Ummah needs doctors, they need lawyers, they need scientists, they need engineers. And I disagree with that. Because there is enough Muslim doctors, there is enough lawyers, scientists, engineers. But what we lack here is Muslims that are prepared to suffer and sacrifice.
Azam.com's offshoot, Azam Publications, would sell such videos, shot on cheap camcorders in Bosnia, Chechnya, the West Bank and Gaza, and anywhere else Muslims were fighting jihad.
For many years I followed Babar Ahmad, and many times I used to think this was someone who indeed had the same skills that I did.
Evan Coleman lives and breathes computers and works as a consultant for the FBI and other US agencies. His life is spent monitoring websites, chat rooms, message boards and videos devoted to violent jihad.
I followed Azam.com closer than I followed news from my own family. This guy really was the leader of a small group of people who even as far back as 1996 realized the importance of the internet in terms of the larger war, a larger terrorist war around the world.
Around that time, back in Tooting, Andrew and his friends started logging on to Azam.com.
What effect did it have on you? Why did you access it?
Azam was an English website for a start. That made a lot of impact. An English website that covered a controversial issue, which is the issue of jihad. When the first set of images started coming through of murdered children, murdered women, murdered men, it has that kind of like a shock jock effect, like, you know, wow.
But the jihadis aren't having it all their own way out there in the icy wastes of cyberspace. One person knows more than most about how they communicate and operate. She's penetrated their world with extraordinary consequences for those who thought the anonymity of the web would protect them. And she's not a spook. Shannon Rossmiller is an ordinary mum in a small town in the Midwest. She's also the local magistrate. She's a patriot fighting America's war on terror in her own particular way.
How did you get into this? How did you get involved?
Well, September 11th was a day that pretty much changed my life. I got angry, upset, and a lot of tears were shed, and I wanted to, eventually, I guess, I think how it started was I wanted to understand how something like this could happen, who would do it. And so ultimately that kind of led me to try and learn more about the terrorist groups and the ideology and the mindset.
In the early hours of the morning, whilst her family sleeps, Shannon hunts for Islamist terrorists on the net. She knows she's dealing with a cunning enemy, but she believes she can outwit them.
One thing led to another. I decided I wanted to try and see if I could pass myself off as an extremist. You know, I thought, well, what the heck, you know? Let's see if I could make it fly. After I had observed things for several months, you gradually get more knowledge and more courage.
With the help of an Arabic-speaking friend and translation software, Shannon created a new online identity. Anyone trying to pinpoint her computer would find it apparently located in Germany.
They knew they were talking to a woman, an infidel. I mean, of course, you know, they'd probably close the place down and relocate, but when I develop a personality that I you know, subsequently go to use online, I will pick a country and pick a city or, you know, a part of a city, find out where the mosques are.
Last year, she logged onto bravemuslims.com and got talking to an Abdul Rashid. He wrote in English, but like her, he was hiding behind an alias. Using the address khadija1417@hotmail.com, Shannon replied, advising him to be more discreet, and said,
"Like you, I am engaged in the struggle within the nest of the enemy. From here, we can be most effective."
He responded,
"Just curious, would there be any chance a brother, who might be on the wrong side at the present, could join up, defect, so to speak?"
It's a bit like fishing, isn't it?
That would be a good way to describe it, because, you know, you got to know what the right bait is to put on the end of the hook to get him to bite.
And he took the bait?
He took the bait.
"I'm due to enter the war zone soon. Perhaps 120 fahirs from now. Unfortunately, due to my position, I will be bearing the arms of the enemy."
Did he tell you at any stage what he wanted to do?
Yeah, he definitely indicated that it was his goal to help the enemy by, you know, giving over plans for the M1A1 and M1A2 Abrams tanks to allow a terrorist group to be able to take over those tanks, kill the crew.
His real name was Ryan Anderson. He suggested a face-to-face meeting with one of Shannon's supposed Al-Qaeda contacts. She agreed.
"Your contact is a dedicated soldier, and I believe the two of you will have many things in common."
And Ryan Anderson sent his photograph in.
He did.
"If my death is the will of Allah, I welcome it as an old friend."
Anderson was a Muslim convert and part of a tank crew in the National Guard. His unit was bound for Iraq. Shannon contacted Homeland Security and the FBI. They first checked her out, and then, near Seattle's famous Space Needle, set up a sting operation to trap Anderson in a car park. He came along thinking he was meeting real Al-Qaeda terrorists. He'd no idea undercover FBI agents were waiting for him in the car. He offered details of his unit's deployment in Iraq and described his tank's weak points. He was hopelessly out of his depth. He got 5 life sentences before a military court. It was only then he discovered that he'd been talking to Shannon Rossmiller and not an Al-Qaeda go-between.
In court, when you saw the face of the man you'd been communicating with over the internet, and when you heard the judge sentence him to 5 life imprisonments, what was your reaction?
When you put it in a perspective of 5 life terms, that's enormous, that's huge. That's an impact on somebody's whole life that you don't ever think you're gonna, you know, deal with yourself.
And you put him there?
And I put him there. It was hard. It was really hard, you know.
Did you have any sympathy for it?
No, I did for his wife. I did for his mom and his father. Just because I'm a mother myself, and I would hope that I would never find myself in their position, and what agony they must be going through as parents to have, you know, their child, you know, be deemed what is a traitor, and that's essentially what he is.
But Shannon's hunt is just a blip in cyberspace compared with the vast potential of the web to fuel international terrorism. The authorities are especially concerned about websites that host training manuals, an online library of how to make bombs and poisons, how to kidnap and kill. This is a step-by-step guide on how to make a suicide bomber's vest.
You can now, in the comfort of your home in Sydney or in Bangkok, download those parts of the manual you want to study, whether it's bomb making or small unit combat tactics or paramedic activities for combat medics, they can be downloaded at home and eliminate the need for travel.
The site that we're looking at here is known as the Islamic Internet Security Center. This right here is an actual terrorist training camp inside of Iraq. You'll notice that they're practicing firing on different buildings, urban assault projects, basically. And if you fast forward through the video, right here we see the men learning on how to use a mortar with an instructor teaching them. This guy is showing them how to use the mortar. To the class, the next class of terrorists. And these are lessons, I might add, not just for those that are in the video, but these are also lessons that carry over for those that watch the video over the internet, people like us.
So you can learn how to do it just watching the video?
It's showing.
Except first you've got to get your mortar.
This may be true, but a lot of times the weapons that they're showing here are homemade weapons.
One of the internet's most frequently accessed training manuals is called Al-Batar Camp. It shows you everything from how to shoot down helicopters to how to choose the best weapon for a particular job. Its author used to run training camps in Saudi Arabia before they were closed down. His work now lives on in cyberspace.
Let's just have a look at one of the websites which is on the forum attached to your website. Will you tell me what it is?
This is essentially it's a magazine. The word batara originally means amputate. So the amputator, but this is the name of the sword, because the sword has various names in Arabic. One of them is al-Battar.
And what's the purpose of al-Battar?
The purpose of al-Battar is to assist the jihadi with education, information, including even arms, information, G3, description of the G3 gun, etc. So it contains intellectual articles and contains also issues about weapons, etc.
It's like a jihadi...
Yeah,
do-it-yourself correspondence course.
Yeah, completely. And that's also recently someone was able to snatch away the American manuals about light arms and demolition, and he distributed that also on the internet.
Who's it aimed at?
Who is it aimed at? I think there's a wide and diverse audience, but I think this is where we have one of the biggest misconceptions in the whole field of terrorism. This is not aimed at people that are in far-off places in the world, from small, isolated communities, from poor families. We're talking about a science that is aimed at middle-class Muslim youths in Western cities, places where technology is as easy to come by as is water or food. You can walk into any cyber cafe in the world, in any major city, and find this stuff. But it's really, it's aimed at a young generation, a youthful generation, for whom the internet, it's as simple as 1, 2, 3. It's natural, it flows naturally.
Many who download Al-Batar and such manuals may be pure fantasists playing at jihad without the commitment and the blood, just like a video game.
But the internet for many is just a game.
Peter, you're missing the point. If you have these instructions on the internet, if it's not gonna be that X guy who posted the message, then it will be Y. It's out there already. It doesn't matter who's going to do it.
If they do.
Look, if they do it, you don't have enough suicide operation in this world. There have been attacks all over the world, or potential attacks that were prevented in the last minute.
The Madrid train bombers were not prevented. Computers seized from their alleged associates are deadly proof of how jihadis use the internet. They contain details of how to detonate explosives by mobile phone. It wasn't a fantasy. The Madrid cell used mobiles to kill 191 commuters. According to the American indictment, equally chilling instructions were found when anti-terrorist police raided the office and home of Baba Ahmed, Azam.com's alleged webmaster. Besides a mass of jihadi material on computers, discs and CDs, they also discovered manuals on how to destroy tanks, planes and helicopters. The Americans also say that Azam.com was active in fundraising, with instructions on how to donate to the Taliban, 2 years after President Clinton made it illegal. Money could be handed over directly to the Taliban Consul General in Karachi. $20,000 was mentioned. The Chechen Mujahideen were also grateful. This is an endorsement by one of its leaders, Ibn Khattab.
الشباب إلا أنه لعله مؤسسة أو عزام بلوكيشن يعني من الأخوة القريبين مننا وعلى اتصال معنا دائم حفظهم الله. فمن يريد أن يرسل أو يساعد أو يطلب أي معلومات أو أوضاع أو أحوال يتصل بهؤلاء الأخوة أو يتصل فينا مباشرة على التليفون. الأخوة هم يعرفونه ممكن يتصل معنا.
But the web can also be a jihadi Achilles heel. Emails are routinely intercepted by the National Security Agency's vast listening post at Fort Meade, Maryland. It's America's equivalent of Britain's GCHQ. Its operations are top secret.
What is the NSA's role in the war on terror? What does it do?
They're responsible for intercepting, translating, breaking the codes on various types of communications, whether it's telephones, computers, radios.
How adept is the NSA at intercepting and analyzing the email communications between the various component parts of Al-Qaeda?
That's such a sensitive thing, I can't talk about that, Peter.
Americans are now discovering that their private emails can be routinely monitored if they become suspects. The intelligence agencies claim that the surveillance of a young Muslim in New York justifies the intrusion. He was a member of an extreme Muslim sect who'd returned home to New York from Pakistan last year. He'd originally gone out there to help foreign jihadis cross into Afghanistan to fight the Americans. In Pakistan, he worked with this young British Muslim from Manchester, Hassan Butt.
He was doing the same things I was doing, which was just helping those brothers who wanted to go in to get military training. He was a kind person, a very considerate person. He was someone who was very strong-headed and very courageous. I remember in some demonstrations that were taking places that he would always lead at the front and not be afraid of being beaten by the police batons.
Whilst in Pakistan, Hassan's friend, whom we can't name for legal reasons, was interviewed soon after the American invasion of Afghanistan.
When the American troops enter, we will kill them in Afghanistan. There is no negotiation with the Americans. When they're coming in with the mindset to kill my Muslim brothers and sisters, I will do the same on the front line. I will kill every American that I see.
Were you surprised when he said that he was prepared to kill every American that he could find?
No. I think the sentiments of 90% of the Muslim population in Pakistan would, that if they had the ability to do so, they would do that.
Hassan met up again with his American friend when he stopped off in London last year.
Did he say anything to you?
Nothing at all, except he never even informed me that he was going back to America. I guessed that he was travelling back to America. We hadn't discussed any of the things he'd been involved in, and neither did I want to discuss anything of the things that he'd want to be involved in.
When Hassan's friend returned to New York, the FBI placed him under surveillance. They suspected him of serious terrorist offences, which again, for legal reasons, we can't go into. They watched him go into internet cafes and, on at least two occasions, into the New York Public Library, not to borrow a book, but to use the public computers. The FBI then scrutinised the hard disks to check what he'd been saying. They discovered he'd been emailing other suspects. They then arrested him. The US Patriot Act, hastily passed after 9/11, enables the FBI to access private emails.
Law enforcement agencies can go into public libraries and look at what you've been doing on your computer. Is that necessary?
I think it probably is necessary. Clearly, if bin Laden was a paper tiger, there would be no need for the Patriot Act or concerns about civil liberties. But because he is so much more than that and so dangerous a threat, we're now faced with the problem of how to defend the United States and still protect the civil liberties of our citizens.
It's a dilemma Britain faces too as the government introduces ever tougher laws to counter the terrorist threat. The UK's intelligence services now also have to deal with the cyber jihadis.
An individual obviously can go to an internet cafe, can set up an account very easily, and the identity of the person using that account is completely unknown and anonymous, and so that obviously gives opportunities for terrorists to exploit the internet as a means of secure communication.
A recent case illustrates the point. Sajid Badat from Gloucester travelled to Afghanistan, worked in IT for the Taliban, and trained in a terrorist camp. He later told police that he'd intended to become a shoe bomber like Richard Reid, but he changed his mind. Reid and Badat were in email contact with each other.
It's a very worrying case. Here was a young man, well-educated, well-liked, from a very good family, living, to all intents and purposes, an entirely normal life, enjoying sports, did well at school, and yet somehow he ended up in a position where he was prepared and fully intended to bring down an airliner containing hundreds of innocent men, women and children.
We all know the intelligence services can tap our telephones, but it may come as some surprise that they can now access our emails.
There are means by which we can, with appropriate authorities, retrieve material from the internet.
It's like putting a tap on a telephone.
It's different to putting a tap on the telephone, but the essential structures around gaining legal authority to do so are in some ways similar.
So if I'm a suspected terrorist and you've got me under surveillance and I go into an internet cafe, when I've gone, you can get authorization to search the hard drive and find out what I've been doing and whom I've been talking to?
There are a range of things which can be done, but you'll understand that for obvious reasons I'm not going to say exactly what it is we can do.
America has a built-in protection that the UK does not. Many US citizens are concerned that legal corners are being cut and privacy violated without proper cause. They cite the protection they're due under the First Amendment of the US Constitution that guarantees freedom of speech. Here, anyone can say what they like about anything or anybody.
It's frightening to see the power that the American government has to invade the privacy of individuals.
Attorney Cheryl Nance experienced the bite of the Patriot Act when her client Majid went missing in Seattle.
My client has expressed admiration for Osama bin Laden, very strong views about the United States' intervention in Muslim countries, but my client is not an advocate of violence.
What happened to him?
He basically disappeared without anyone's knowledge.
He disappeared?
He disappeared.
Majid was arrested on a drugs charge, but the body of the prosecution evidence was about terrorism, not drugs. An airliner's seating plan without explanation and the Albatar training manuals were found on his computer. Majid's father turns out to be none other than Dr. Mohammed Al-Masari. Majid helped run his website.
Presumably your son shares your views.
Essentially the same views, yeah.
So why is he on trial in America?
The Americans detained him in July claiming that he has a previous drug conviction. Most likely he experimented someday with cocaine. Nothing selling or something like that, but most young people will fall in these traps from time to time.
Are they trying to get you through your son?
I think so. I'm quite convinced. But they will not. They will not succeed.
And he may be right. Majid Al-Masari is in this detention center near Seattle, pending possible deportation. He fears torture if he's sent back to Saudi Arabia. Majid's defense is based on the First Amendment. As a result, he may be freed. Baba Ahmed's lawyers will be watching the outcome closely. If he is extradited to America, they may argue a similar defense. But such a special pleading doesn't go down well with Shannon Rossmiller, who's now protected by the FBI. She was happy for us to show her face, though not say where she lives. And she's still hunting terrorists on the net. Recently, she got another bite from a country that she's asked us not to reveal. The man said that he'd fought the British near Basra and wanted help to go back.
This one was rather surprising. I've not had an email like this. This right here represents essentially what you could classify as a shopping list of items and materials he would need to engage in making bombs, other weapons, as well as some items that could be used in certain small items of chemical weapons.
As before, Shannon passed on the information.
He's out of business. He's been scooped up and taken away for a long time. And
where to?
Who knows?
I don't
ask.
Does that worry you that they may be being tortured, ill-treated to get the information out of them?
I'm kind of torn on that a little. Anybody that cares for human rights on any level would hope that that would never have to come to that. What, on the other side of things, though, just knowing what I've learned in the last couple of years in this type of world, is they don't play games. I think in the greater good of humanity, a little torture might go a long way to preventing something from being carried out.
Are you tracking anybody at the moment?
Oh, of course. Several.
In May, a court in London ruled that Baba Ahmed could be extradited after the Americans further alleged he'd tried to set up a terrorist training camp in Arizona. Appeals are in the pipeline. The outcome may settle the issue of whether someone running a jihadi website can be guilty of terrorism.
Unfortunately, Baba has been made an scapegoat.
Free! Free! Baba Ahmed!
Free! Free! Baba Ahmed!
He's accused of giving material support to terrorists. He's accused of supporting the Chechen Mujahideen, of helping finance the Taliban. These are serious charges.
This information is false. I have sufficient... I've got various evidence in my possession in relation to some of the matters that have been raised, which will show that the information is false and fabricated against this defendant.
Is your client a terrorist?
No. If he was a terrorist, he would have been charged in this country and the evidence would have been adduced in this country.
As Azam.com closed down after 9/11, its webpage carried an open letter to the so-called 19 Lions, the hijackers of the planes that attacked New York and Washington.
It sends a chill down your spine. The first few paragraphs are a fictional retelling of the last moments of the 9/11 hijackers from a first-hand perspective. Fasten your seatbelt, the sign flashes. You buckle up. The safety video plays. You ignore it as usual. This is someone retelling what the 9/11 hijackers did right before they committed the greatest act of violence in modern history, glorifying it, saying Allahu Akbar as you graciously glide into the tower, obliterating an idol of the modern age.
Though Azam.com has also been obliterated, its alleged webmaster, Baba Ahmed, lives on, fittingly, via the internet. He's the subject of FreeBabaAhmed.com, which presents him as a martyr to political repression, the innocent child now hounded by Blair and Bush. Parliament is now considering legislation that will oblige internet companies to give authorities details of the emails and internet activity of any terrorist suspect, and the police have now raided Dr. Al-Masari's house, but he's not been charged or cowed.
I think the Islamic activists are definitely winning. You cannot win a war if you don't have a cause, and the tools to win that war.
And the internet spreads the word about that cause.
Yeah, they cannot survive without it. They can. But then the process of disseminating, educating, mobilizing will take, instead of 1 year, it takes 50 years.
The internet is an indispensable tool to Al-Qaeda. Probably one of the most grievous ways to hurt Al-Qaeda would be to shut off their access to the internet, which I think they know, and we know, is clearly an impossibility.
This is the new Wild West. It's an area where potentially a terrorist can go online, can communicate, can trade information, and still can be immune from prosecution or identification.
In the end, the Wild West was tamed. Will the internet be tamed?
Well, here's the problem, is the internet is a transnational entity. It spreads across borders, and it spreads across borders into countries that A, do not have the ability to effectively police the internet, or B, do not have particularly any particular desire to do so.
I think the Wild West ought to be tamed. I can't quite understand for the life of me why it is legal in any country for there to be pictures on the internet of someone being beheaded. I just can't understand it. Why can organizations operate on the internet and advocate the death of innocent men, women, and children? It seems to me that internationally we were able to get a hold of other areas that were uncontrolled, and we ought to be able to get a hold of the internet and at the same time protect individual freedoms.
The venom of some radical British Muslims was again apparent during May's general election campaign. A group again invaded Regent's Park Mosque and interrupted a press conference held by the moderate Muslim Council of Britain.
This is Allah created the whole of the earth for the Muslims. Whether you like it or not, Islam is going to be victorious. Whether you like it or not, Islam is going to take over UK, take over Washington.
Above all, it's political issues that fire Muslims' anger and fuel the jihadi internet. Issues like Palestine, Chechnya, Kashmir, and now Iraq. Taming the Wild West of the internet, were that ever possible, is only attacking the symptom and not the underlying cause of the fury of Muslims like these.
Who's winning the war?
I think the Islamists are winning the war hands down, at least in terms of the United States. Our politicians, either because they're ignorant or they're not willing to tell the truth, continue to tell the American people that this war is aimed at our liberties and our freedoms and our election system and our quest for gender equality, when that really has almost nothing to do with it. Until the American people are squared with, and our president, whether Democrat or Republican, says they're mad at our policies in the Islamic world and the impact those policies have, you have to say America is losing simply because we haven't taken the measure of our enemy.